Brethren, we need to express our sincere gratitude unto God Almighty for this great opportunity he has given unto us once again to come to dine with him, to come in response to his glorious call, come for all things are now ready. The blessings of today are ready and we have been invited. Thank God for the grace of God to come. Let's exalt and bless the name of the Lord God Almighty that he has counted us worthy to be among those who responded. Let us bless his holy name. Let's thank God for the sound sleep he granted unto us last night. He fulfilled his faithful promise. He giveth his beloved sleep. The sleep of the righteous is sweet. Brethren, you know there are people who can't sleep without taking sleep medication, melatonin, Benadryl, and all those other trazodone, Restorin. They can't, and even then, within 1.5 hours, sleep is gone. Glorify God Almighty. What they are paying for, and they are not getting the full result, we are getting free of charge and the fullness of sleep. Let's thank and bless the name of the Lord for that which Jesus Christ told his disciples and by extension unto us in Luke chapter 10. Rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Glorify God. Majority of the people. I was watching a crowd of campaign yesterday. I saw sea of it. I said, Lord, how many of these people have their names in the book of life? I don't know. Majority are talking about politics. But brethren, let us rejoice because our names are written in heaven. Glorify God. Is your name written in the book of life? Praise God. What about your spouse? What about your children? Let's cry unto the Lord God Almighty. If any of these people, their names are not in that book of life, oh Lord, do something today. This is the day of the Lord. John the Beloved said, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and he got revelation. We are in the spirit on the Lord's day. Let God do something unique in the salvation of members of our families. Let's pray that the Lord God Almighty, by the Spirit of God, will create in them the desire to hunger and thirst after God, after righteousness. There has to be a desire and a thirst. That's the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. As a magnet draws a metal, let the Lord draw them unto himself. This morning we have come, like those two people that came to the disciples of Jesus. They said, we're not looking for Peter, we're not looking for Andrew, we're not looking for James, we're not looking for anybody. We want to see Jesus. Brethren, let's ask the Lord that we have come to see the Lord Jesus Christ through the ministration he will minister unto us today through the oracles of God. We have come with one purpose, to see the Lord. We want to see Jesus. Anything that will keep Jesus away from our seeing him this morning, sin, let's pray that the Lord will wash us, wash our sins away, and make us pure and holy. We want to see Jesus. Brethren, let's keep ourselves in remembrance of this great event we are waiting for, the rapture of the saints. The Bible says, in the twinkling of an eye. And that's a mystery. We shall not all sleep, we shall not all die, but we will all be changed. The Lord himself will descend from heaven with the shout and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we, which are alive, will follow suit. For a period of 7 years, the marriage supper of the Lord. Wonderful. Let's pray that the Lord will give us the grace to keep our garment of righteousness from every spot, wrinkle, or blemish. We will be like the wise virgins. It is holiness unto the Lord now and forever. Holiness unto the Lord is our watchword and song. Holiness unto the Lord, as we are marching along, we will sing it, we will shout it, loud and long, goodness unto the Lord, now and forever. Now, what would you take to get to heaven? For those who do not believe out there, they say, oh, there is nothing like rapture. Show us rapture in the Bible, and I will tell you, I will show you catching away in the Bible, and I will tell you the rapture had happened before. Look at what happened unto Elijah, unto Enoch, he's gone. Elijah went. Jesus Christ also went. The next one will be you and I. We will go to be with the Lord. Because we believe, we are expecting. Those who don't believe and are not expecting, the rapture will not catch up with them. The thought of the rapture, be ready. Jesus said, watch and pray, watch and pray. That's what keeps us on the path of holiness. Every time you examine yourself, they say, ah, deeper life, people, they're always conscious of sin. Why wouldn't you be conscious of sin so that you don't slip and fall? Let's commit Nigeria into the hand of God Almighty. That Lord Jesus, you say, for the sake of the elect, oh Lord God, let there be peace. We are staying here. We have not raptured. If we had raptured, we say, whatever that happens there, let it happen unto them. But Lord, we are staying here on earth. Oh Lord, let there be peace. The plan of the enemy to kill, to shed blood, that is enough. Since 2015, there have been a lot of bloodshed in Nigeria. Oh Lord, stay the hand of the enemy. Elect for us your choice, oh Lord God. No matter what the devil plans, oh Lord God, the will of God must be done. We want peace on every side in Nigeria. Oh, I remember the 70s. I remember the 80s. Oh, Lord God. Relative peace. On the highway, you scarcely find it. Police checkpoints are just one or two, just to maintain. But this time, people are afraid to get out of their homes. This is not right. Lord, grant peace in Nigeria. I remember those days, within 7 hours, I've driven from Lagos to my father's house. No problem, nothing. Oh Lord, restore peace in Nigeria. Take away kidnapping. Ritual killing, enough is enough. Oh Lord. We here, we are like Nehemiah in the palace in Shusha. We are concerned about what's going on in our country, our place of nativity, the place of our father's sepulchre, the place we were born and raised up in the ministry of the Lord. Lord, we are concerned. Do something, O Lord God, for our great country, Nigeria. Nehemiah and the palace in Shushan, everything is okay, but that man was concerned about his kinsmen in Israel, about the wall of Jerusalem, about the gate of Jerusalem. Hanani said, oh, everything is terribly bad. The people that escaped the captivity, they are in great affliction. The wall of Jerusalem is down. The gate is burned. That man started to seek the face of the Lord. This morning, brethren, we will seek the face of the Lord. Say, Father, the news we are hearing is not palatable. Reign peace in our country, Lord. Let's commit this morning's assembly in the hand of God Almighty. The Bible says, the very word of Jesus, where two or three are gathered together in his name, there he is in the midst of them, that the Lord Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, the Holy Spirit, that will energize us and teach us and put us to remembrance, that he will fulfill his promise in our lives today, so that by the time we finish, we will say we have never seen it like this fashion. Let's commit all the ministers that the Lord will use today, the moderators, the sign, the scripture teacher, the songs we will sing, the question and the answer, the sermon, for everything. Let's package everything and present them before the Lord and say, Lord, bless us through all that we're going to do this morning. The anointing that breaks the yoke. We need it this morning. Let's pray it down. The anointing that brings the blessings of the Lord. Let's ask for it this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father, we thank you, Almighty God, for this morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. We are glad and we are happy therein. The everlasting Father, the scripture said, I was glad when they said, come, follow me. Let us go to the house of the Lord. At a time like this, oh Lord God, the best place to be is to be in the house of the Lord. No wonder David said, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Oh, Father, we will dwell with you throughout eternity. And this morning, we have come in your presence, oh Lord God, to have a taste of what it will be when we dwell with you throughout eternity, oh Lord God. Father, bless your children, manifest your presence, O Lord, in Jesus' name. Father, we look unto you that all of us, O Lord God, as we have come this morning, we will declare in the end, we have never had it in this fashion before. We have never had it like this ever before. Let there be a difference, O Lord God, between today and the previous services, in Jesus' name. Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Over to moderator.
Amen. We're going to start our Sunday fellowship today by singing from our gospel hymn and song, hymn number 80. Alas, did my Savior bleed? And did my sovereign die? Will he devote that sacred head for such a one as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the way. Hymn number 80. Amen. It's time for our study scripture. Let's be seated, please.
In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Our great God in heaven, we bless you and thank you for this wonderful morning. Thank you for your presence in our midst. Thank you for Calvary. Thank you for the finished work of grace that Jesus perfected at Calvary. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together for the Sunday worship service this morning. As we come into your presence, Lord, we pray that your power and grace will be with us. Lord, we pray that this morning, the resurrection power of Jesus will inject us and you will renew and reinvigorate us in Jesus' name. We give you all the glory. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Last week we looked at the trial of Jesus. In our study, 879. And in that study, we saw that Jesus Christ was brought to trial before Pilate, not because he did anything wrong, just because his accusation essentially was that he said he was the Son of God. Jesus did not commit any sin. He lived a righteous, a perfect life. But because it was ordained that he must die, God permitted him to go through that route. We saw in that trial that he was unshakable. He was unmoved. Why? Because he knew that he has a commitment. He has a job to do. He was arraigned before the high priest. And the high priest were supposed to defend him because they were the high priest of God. And here was the Son of God. But the high priest wanted him dead. Why? Because his life challenged their life. His life was a contrast to their fake, false life. And then we see that when eventually was brought before Pilate, he could have freed himself, but he yielded completely to the will of God. The claim. Also, we saw the courage and the conduct that he has during the trial. He was not perturbed. He was not disturbed. Why? Because he knew that God was with him. So in those lessons last week, we learned that if Jesus was tried, we as believers will also be tried. Our trial would be completely different from his. It might not be the one that will lead to immediate death. But trust me, as Christians, trials and temptations abound. My prayer is that the Lord will give us the grace to overcome every one of them in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. So that brings us to today's study. And our study today is a follow-up from the last week on. And we are looking at the subject, the crucifixion and burial of Christ. The crucifixion. After he was tried, he was condemned to die. He was condemned to die not because he sinned, but because his way was contrary to the way of the world. And the devil was behind his trial and crucifixion, but God permitted it because that was the plan and purpose of God for him at that time. So the study today is lesson 880, the crucifixion and burial of Christ. The memory verse is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3 to 4. Let's read it together. One, two, go. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he arose again the third day, according to the scriptures. Let's read it again. One, two, go. For I delivered unto you first of all that which also I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 3 and 4. The text is John chapter 19 from verse 1 to 42. Sister Joy, can you help us to read it, please? John chapter 19. We're going to read the whole verses 1 to 42.
John chapter 19, from verse 1 to 42. I read. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers planted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe and said, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and said unto them, "Behold, I bring him forth to you, that he may know that I find no fault in him." Then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns and a purple robe, and Pilate said unto them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests therefore and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said unto them, "Take ye him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." Verse 7. The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he was the more afraid, and went again into the judgment hall, and said unto Jesus, "Whence art thou?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Then said Pilate unto him, "Speakest thou not unto me? Knowest thou not that I have power to crucify thee and have power to release thee?" Jesus answered, "Thou couldest have no power at all against me, except it were given thee from above. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee had the greater sin." Verse 12. And from thenceforth, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, "If thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whosoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar." When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, but in the Hebrew, Gabbatha. Verse 14. And it was the preparation of the Passover, about the sixth hour. And he said unto the Jews, "Behold your king." But they cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." Pilate said unto them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priest answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Verse 16. Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of a skull. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of a skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two other with him, on either side one, and two other with him on either side one, and Jesus in the midst. Verse 19. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." The title then read many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city. And it was written in Hebrew and Greek and Latin. Then said the chief priests of the Jews to Pilate, "Write not the King of the Jews, but that he said, 'I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Verse 23. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garment and made four parts, to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout. They said therefore among themselves, "Let us not rend it, but cast lot for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which said, departed my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lot. That these things, therefore, the soldiers did. Verse 25. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples standing by, whom he loved, he said unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then said to the disciples, Behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. And there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar, and put it upon hyssop, and put it to his mouth. Verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, It is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost.
Thank you, my sister. We'll stop from here because of time. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Look at verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, It is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. That was the completion, the fulfillment of his crucifixion. Our lesson this week brings us to the judgment hall of Pilate, the Roman prosecutor where Jesus was tried and confirmed innocent. Before Jesus' arrest, he himself established his absolute purity, because in John chapter 14, verse 30, he asked the people, and he told the people, the prince of the world cometh and had nothing in me. There was no sin in Jesus. Jesus was sinless. What a challenge to all Christians to maintain a consistent holy life every time, everywhere, and at every place. Ordinarily, the proof of innocence, not only by the accused, but by the judge, is a legal basis for acquitting a suspect of all allegations leveled against him. But in the case of Jesus, it was different. The judge said he has not sinned. Pilate said, I found nothing in him. And yet, he was sentenced to death. So everything about the judgment of Jesus was completely contrary to normalcy. But the question is, why did he go that way? Because it was written that it has to be so. God permitted it. And what a great lesson we learned, that nothing can happen to us except God permits it. And also on the flip side, you will learn here that God will permit some hardship, some persecution, some trials to come our way, not necessarily because we are guilty, no, to fulfill his plan. Are you following me? Because in the case of Jesus, nobody found him guilty. Even the judge, which was Pilate, said, I found him, there's nothing in him. If I got to a point that he got water and washed his hand, that which was a proof that this man was innocent. But at the same time, they still crucified him. And believers today will be confused. Why is it I'm living a righteous life? I'm holy. And yet, the trials are permitted. Because those trials are simply to fulfill the will of God. Jesus died according to the purpose and the plan of God. So everything about the trial was monitored, orchestrated, allowed by God. God was not the one that brought him to the judgment place, but he allowed Satan to do that because he was in fulfillment of his plan. So we're going to look at the study under 3 points. Point number one, the cruel trial of Jesus Christ. Then we'll look at point number two, the crucifixion and death of Jesus Christ. And then finally, point number three will be the burial of Jesus Christ. So let's go back to point number one. the cruel trial of Jesus Christ. Come to John chapter 19. In John, a memory verse, chapter 19. You see the story in verse 1 to 5. John chapter 19 from verse 1. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him and beat him up. Scourging means beating, terrible beating by the soldiers. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe and said, that's the soldiers, in a mocking way, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they smote him with their hands. They beat him up. Pilate therefore went forth again and said unto them, "Behold, I bring him forth to you, that ye may know that I find no fault in him." See that? Pilate said, who was the judge, "This man you brought before him, I don't find any fault in him." Verse 5. Then came Jesus forth wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate said unto them, to the Jews, "Behold the man." When the chief priests, therefore, and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said unto them, "Take ye him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." Verse 7, the Jews answered him, "We have a law, and by our law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." How can you crucify a human being? Can you kill somebody because he said, "I'm a son of God"? What has he done wrong? He has not affected anyone. You see the religiousness of people today. That is why you find the people of the other religion, the other one, I don't want to mention the name, they are ready to kill in the name of their religion. And it's satanic. Because if that religion was godly, it's not going to ask you to kill a person. But because it's satanic, these people have so much drifted, the Israelites have drifted so far, the chief priests have drifted, that they can't even reason anymore. They were killing people, killing a righteous man, all in the name of religion. And in verse 8, when Pilate therefore had that saying, he was the more afraid. Why was he more afraid? It's like, how can this person, son of God? Whoa, this one says he's a son of God. Pilate too was a little bit afraid because he knew that God was big. Even though he was not a believer in God, he knew there was a God. Verse 9, and he went again into the judgment hall and said unto Jesus, "Whence art thou?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Then said Pilate unto him, "Speakest thou not unto me? Knowest thou not that I have power to crucify thee and have power to release thee?" No, Pilate, you don't have it. It's only in the hand of God. So when people come bragging, when agents of the devil come bragging, don't be afraid. They'll brag, "I have power to do this, I have power to do that." That's what Pilate did. Well, let's hear what Jesus answered him. Jesus answered, that's when you have to speak up. Because there's power of word. Sometimes you need to speak up. Don't allow people to place an evil word on you and just keep them quiet. Refuse it, renounce it, reject it. Look at verse 11. Jesus answered, "Thou couldst have no power at all against me, except it were given thee from above. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee had the greater sin." Jesus told him plainly, "No, you don't have power over me. What is going on here is God permitted it, and I'm doing the will of God. Ordinarily, you cannot touch me. You cannot do me anything. It's because I'm doing the will of God. That's why all this is happening." Verse 12, and from thenceforth, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, saying, "If thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whosoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar." Verse 13, when Pilate therefore had that saying, what saying? If you release this man, you are not a friend of Caesar. Caesar is the only king we know. Look at these people, the people of God that worship Jehovah. Just to make sure they crucified Jesus, they began to confess negatively. They forgot their God and they make Caesar their king. They say, "Yeah, we accept Caesar as our king, as long as you kill this man. Just kill him. Caesar is now our king, not God anymore." These were hypocritical people. And the private in the temple, they would tell God, God, you are the only king. Here in the public, they were able to tell everybody that the only king they have was Pilate. What a hypocritical people. So that was why they were contrary to the will of God. They were already backsliding from the God of heaven. And the only man that was standing, Jesus and his disciples, what were they doing? They were now persecuting them. My prayer is that the Lord will help us so that we stay in the grace and not be like the hypocrites, the Israelites in those days, in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. Now, if you look at John chapter 19, verse 1 that I read, he said, then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. Now, the injury inflicted on Jesus' body is more severe than the casual reader of the Bible will read. You know, just say, oh, they scourged him. Okay, maybe they just beat him a little bit. No, it was a horrible beating because they were about to crucify him. So they had no mercy on him. In their heart, he's going to die anyway. So beat him really hard. So you can think of somebody that is already condemned, that is going to be killed. When they're beating such a person, it's going to be merciless. So the beating was terrible. It's not anything that you wish for your worst enemy. So they really, really beat him bad. Now, I have this question. And I want Sister Vero. Let me see who and who we have here today. People that didn't answer last week. Let me see. Yes, from the Afolabis. Let's have somebody, if it's not there, Brajibo, get ready to answer this question for us. The question is going to be, describe Jesus' attitude during his trial. What does this teach us about our conduct when we are under persecution? That's going to be the question, but don't answer it yet. When the time comes, I will tell you. With the question number two, describe Jesus' attitude during his trial. What does this teach us about our conduct when we are under persecution? That's the question. All right. In each of the trials, Jesus never spoke in self-defense. No one spoke on his behalf, and he was eventually condemned to death by crucifixion. He had done no violence, neither was any deceit found in his mouth, just as prophesied by Isaiah in chapter 53 and in verse 9. He did not do any violence at all. Let's look at that. Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53 and in verse 9. Let's see the prophecy about Jesus even before this happened. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Now, this is the testimony of Jesus. And this was what actually happened in his days. Now, come with me to New Testament. If that was a prophecy, in reality, what happened? Come to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14. I read from verse 56. Mark chapter 14, from verse 56. We're looking at the innocency of Jesus. Verse 56. Mark 14, 56. I'll read to 59. And the chief priests and all the council sought for witness against Jesus to put him to death. And what? They found none. Nobody could testify that he has done anything wrong. He couldn't find a single witness. Now, 57, and there arose certain and bear false witness against him, saying, the witnesses that came up were false. What did they say? 58, we heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and within 3 days, I will build another made without hands. Now, this is a lie. Jesus didn't say, I will destroy this temple made with hand. And another 3 days, I will build another made without hand. No, Jesus simply said, destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up. That's all he said. But they misquoted what he said here. And they bear a false witness. These were base fellows. These were criminals. These were bad people. So there was no authentic testimony that was or witness to witness that he did anything wrong. And by the way, these testifiers here only spoke of things that he did not even carry out. They say he said he will, but he didn't do it. How are you going to judge a man based on what he said? He has not even done it yet. So these were all false witnesses. They couldn't find anything against him. 59, but neither so did their witness agree together. Even the witnesses, their witnesses did not agree together. He did not collaborate. And yet they still crucified him. Why? Because Jesus came to die. Now, this is a great example for believers under persecution or false accusation to be spirit controlled in conduct and speech. Pilate made frantic attempts to release Jesus, but the Jews resisted. He eventually succumbed to their pressure to crucify the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, he delivered him to their will. This shouldn't appear strange. There wasn't any way Pilate could have persuaded the wicked Pharisees and Sadducees to let Jesus go. The Jews wanted to kill the Lord. The only thing Pilate could do to save the Lord from death was to apply his official authority and veto the release of Jesus. But the fear of the Jews revolt that may undermine his own position in Caesar's government made him back out of that option. Christians in position of authority should be aware of the Pilate complex, that is, the tendency to ignore the truth and duck justice in order to preserve the honor and privilege of their offices. He that ruleth over men, the scripture admonishes us, must be just, ruling in the fear of the Lord. So now let's go back to the question. Describe Jesus' attitude during this trial. What does this teach us about our conduct when under persecution? Yes.
When under persecution, as we have learned from the attitude of the Lord Jesus Christ, we must be humble and allow the Spirit of God to control our speech, our conduct, our reaction, and know that surely God will fight for us. We must not fight for ourselves, just like the same way he did.
Thank you, my brother. God bless you. Yes, that's very correct. In persecution, we have to be calm, relaxed, having full confidence and faith in God. In fact, in one place, the Bible tells us, if we suffer for our wrongs and we endure it, when we suffer for what we did not do wrong, we say we should also endure, because this is even more acceptable before God. Point number two, because of time, the crucifixion and death of Jesus Christ. So finally, they crucified Jesus. I come to John chapter 19. As you all know, he was crucified. John chapter 19. I read verse 16. I read from verse 16. I'll read some verses there already. We've read it. John chapter 19 from verse 16. Then delivered he him therefore unto them to what? To be crucified. And they took Jesus and what? And they led him away. Now, if you come, verse 17. And he bearing his cross went forth into a place called the place of Askol, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where the what? They crucified him and two other with him on the either side, one and Jesus in the midst. Verse 19, and Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross. The writing was Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. This title then read many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city, and it was written in Hebrew and Greek and Latin. Then said the chief priest of the Jews to Pilate, write not the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am King of the Jews. You see how the devil so much influenced the heart of these people? They never wanted anything to do with Jesus. And yet this was the Messiah that was to save them. This was the Messiah that came to save them. Brethren, that is why we should not marvel that the sinners are so hardened today. The same devil that hardened their heart in those days has not left the world. So to win souls, it would need prayer. It would need persistence, because their heart was so hardened that they hated everything about Jesus. And yes, this was the very God, the very Son of God that they were waiting for. And in verse 22, Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. I can't change that. Now, God was behind this. This was a fulfillment of scripture. And if you come down to 25, now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister. Very important. Now there stood by the cross, not far away. They were just there. They followed Jesus. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples standing by whom he loved, he said unto his mother, woman, behold thy son. Then said he to the disciples, behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciples took her unto his own home. Praise the Lord. In 28, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. 29, now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar, and put it upon hyssop, and put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, what? It is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Praise the Lord. Now, I have this question. Let's have from the Woha family, please, sir, help us with this question. Okay, answer last week. Yeah, we just want to hear your voice, sir. So the question is not yet, but this is the question. Anybody there can answer, either sister or you, sir. The question is, mention important places of significance in Jesus' journey to Calvary and a lesson for believers today. I'll repeat the question again. Mention important places of significance in Jesus' journey to Calvary and the lessons for believers today. So that's the question, but don't answer yet. Now, Jesus carried his own cross at first until he could no longer carry it. Then Simon of Cyrene was forced to help him carry it. That we find in Matthew chapter 27, verse 32. Jesus was led to a place of skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha. There were three places of significance as Jesus journeyed to Calvary. The first place was Gethsemane. This was the place of agony. Let's see what happened there. Matthew chapter 28, the first place, Gethsemane. Matthew chapter 28, let us see what happened in that place. Matthew chapter 26. And I'll read from verse 30 to 40. Matthew 26, 30 to 40. And when they had sung an hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. 31. Then said Jesus unto them, all ye shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock shall be scattered abroad. But after I am risen again, I will go before you into Galilee. Peter answered and said unto him, though all men shall be offended because of thee, yet will I never be offended. Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, that this night before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me what? 3 times. Peter said unto him, though I should die with thee, yet will I not deny thee. Likewise also said all the disciples. Praise the Lord. Now, let's read down 36. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and said unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. Now, remember what happened in verse 33, all right? And notice what Jesus said in verse 31 and 32. That was a message he passed to them. It was not for argument. Jesus told them what was going to happen. So all they needed to do was take it. It was not for them to argue or debate it. What did Jesus say? 31. Then said Jesus unto them, he was passing an information to them, authentic information, true information. All ye shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock shall what? Shall be scattered abroad. That's the prophecy of the Bible. But after I am risen again, I will go before you into Galilee. Peter have no business talking, just keep quiet. But Peter answered and said unto him, prophecy will not be fulfilled. That's what he was saying. Though all men shall be offended because of thee, yet will I never be offended. Really? And verse 34, Jesus says, repeated, Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee that this night before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. What lesson do I learn here? Prophecy will always be fulfilled. The Bible is final authority. We cannot argue the Bible. We cannot argue the prophetic utterances of the Bible. It's a waste of time. And Jesus reemphasizes here. But then I come down now to verse 36. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and said unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. 37. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Notice Jesus left the other disciples behind in verse 36. But he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee with him so that they would pray with him, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Verse 38. Then said he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, and what? Watch with me. Pray with me. 39. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed. God, the watch here means pray. Doesn't mean stay there and watch as a bodyguard. No. It's pray. Jesus wanted, I will show you why that is so. As you are reading, you'll find out. He told them, Peter inclusive, watch with me. So he moved forward and he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, oh, my father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but what? As thou will. 40. And he cometh unto the disciples that were supposed to be watching with him, praying with him, and findeth them asleep. And he said unto them, Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? You see the watching now. Could you not pray with me 1 hour? 41. Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit is what? Indeed willing, but the flesh is what? Weak. Now, if you don't pray, the spirit will be weakened. What Jesus is saying here is that don't be too boisterous. Don't be too bold. Prayer is important. It is not a question of, hey, I know I pray my own prayer. Leave me alone. I don't have to pray. The Bible is telling us that if you don't pray, the weakness of the body will overcome your spirit. Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. If you do not pray, you will enter into temptation. That's what the Bible is saying here. So it is a symbol of finding an antidote to fall into temptation is to pray. If you don't pray, you will always fall into temptation. Jesus said, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. What the spirit, the desire not to fall into temptation is there, but the flesh is weak. 42, he went away again the second time and prayed saying, oh, my father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. God will help us in Jesus' name. 44, and he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then finally, 45, then came he to his disciples and said unto them, sleep on now. They were not supposed to be sleeping before. This is when they could have been sleeping now. So all the while, they were supposed to stay awake and pray. That was a night vigil right there. He says, sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed unto the hands of the sinners. That's the first one, Gethsemane. Now, the second place was Golgotha, and that's the place of judgment. That we find in John chapter 19, verse 13. And then the last place, was Gabbatha, G-A-B-B-A-T-H-A, the place of judgment. That's before Pilate, where he was judged. That place was called Gabbatha, the place of judgment. That we find in John. Let's read that. So it's not going to be my word. Let's say it. John chapter 19. I guess some of us didn't know that was what the place was called. John chapter 19 and in verse 13. Let's hear it from the Bible. John 19, 13. When Pilate therefore had that saying, he brought Jesus forth and sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the what? The pavement, but in the Hebrew, Gabbatha. So you see it there. That was the second place, was the place of judgment, which is called Gabbatha. And the last place was Golgotha, the place of public execution. That's where he was crucified. Jesus bore all agony, judgment, and public execution for the redemption of the human race. Our Lord Jesus was very calm and forgiving in all series of cruelty meted out to him. This teaches the believer that the Christian life is not a bed of roses, but he needs to maintain Christian attitude of forgiving persecutors while praying for the sustaining grace to pass through trials. So let's go back to the question now. So the question, describe Jesus' attitude during his trial. That was the first question. The second question is, mention important places of significance in Jesus' journey to Calvary and the lessons for believers today. Yes, my brother. Praise the Lord. Okay. I have another question here. How did the soldiers unknowingly fulfill the scripture at the crucifixion of Jesus Christ? How did the soldiers unknowingly fulfill the scriptures in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ? There are follow beasts. I want somebody there, either Big Mommy or sister or bro, you get ready for that question. Anybody there? How did the soldiers unknowingly fulfill the scripture at the crucifixion of Jesus Christ? So but don't answer yet, we're going to get into that. At his crucifixion, Pilate instructed that an inscription, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews, be put on the cross. The chief priests resisted this, in their desire to disapprove his kingship, but Pilate prevailed. This single act of Pilate and many other occurrences associated with the death and burial of Jesus Christ showed the fulfillment of prophecy and the exactness of the word of God. Because in John chapter 19, if you read verse 23 to 24, the Bible recorded that then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garment and made four parts, to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout. They said therefore among themselves, let us not rend it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which said, they parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lot. These things therefore the soldiers did, according to John chapter 19, verse 23 and 24. And this was actually a fulfillment of the scripture in Psalm 22, verse 18. They fulfilled scripture without realizing it, because this was exactly a fulfillment of scripture, and that we find in Psalm 22, verse 18. We need to learn some lessons from these people. What are the lessons? One, they showed fortitude as they endured the public scorn and ridicule to which their master was exposed. And who are these people? We are talking about Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary's sister, Mary Magdalene, and John, the disciples. Because these people, they were there present with Jesus when he was crucified. These were the only three people that were mentioned that were physically with Jesus at this time of crucifixion. Where were the other disciples? Nobody was. They were nowhere to be found. And we learned some lessons. One, they showed fortitude as they endured the public scorn and ridicule to which their master was exposed. What is the second thing we learned from them? They showed strong affection for Jesus. And thirdly, they did not forsake Jesus like some disciples did. They stood by Jesus, not just in his hour of joy, fame, and power, but also in his great suffering, trial, and humiliation. We should learn from these little band of people that we must stand with the brethren in the hour of disappointment and despair, not only in the hour of opulence and hilarity. And another thing we learn here is that you find out that these three people, they did not begin to condemn Jesus. Today, unfortunately, in many circles, when believers are passing through trials and persecutions, other believers will begin to look down on them. Oh, maybe they've committed sin. Oh, they are suffering because of their sin. Oh, they don't have this and have that because they committed a secret sin. Jesus was not a secret sin here when he was being persecuted. Was not a sinner. So we have to be careful, as we must be able to identify, to have empathy on our brethren. That's why we are brethren, and the Lord will give us the grace to do that in Jesus' name. Now, while hanging on the cross, Jesus cried for water. This testified to his humanity, because remember that Jesus is fully God and fully human. Now, what was the response of the people? The cruel response to Christ, cry of thirst, was a fulfillment of the scripture. They filled a sponge. The soldiers, they filled a sponge with vinegar. They put a hyssop, on it and gave him to drink. It will be recorded that it was hyssop that the Israelites used to sprinkle the blood on the lintel of their doorpost. The hyssop is just like a shrub. It's the kind of, tree, a small tree that has a shrub in the front where it just kind of smashes on water and then to be able to put on something there. It was something like that. But here, in those days in Israel, they used the same hyssop to sprinkle blood during Passover. And here was the final Passover lamb, Jesus. And they fulfilled the same script. They fulfilled the righteousness of God by giving it to him on the same hyssop. So basically, the Lord was working through everything available to make sure that the fulfillment of scripture is exact and exactly the way it's supposed to be. In Exodus chapter 12, verse 22, now the real Paschal lamb had been slain, and hyssop was used in the beginning, as it was found here in the book of John. Now we have this question. Before we round up, I have this question. So let's go back. Can you give us the answer to the question now, sir?
The soldiers unknowingly fulfilled the scriptures at the crucifixion of Jesus. I think in about three different instances. The first instance is they wrote Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. That was put on the cross, and in a way, there was a prophecy that says that he will be born, and his scepter will be passed on to. We have no hand. That is fulfilling that aspect. The other aspect is they parted his garments, and then they divided it into four. And this was equally a fulfillment of a prophecy where it says the part my, that is Psalm 22 verse 18. They part my garment among them, I cast the lots upon my vesture. And the last aspect was when Jesus said he was thirsty and he was given a drink, and the drink he was given was vinegar to drink. And that is a fulfillment of what was written in Psalm 69 verse 21 that says they gave me also gall for my meat, and in my test they gave me vinegar to drink. Thank you, sir.
All right, God bless you. So because of time, I'm going to just round up. I'm going to show all, there are five benefits of Christ's death. The five benefits of Christ's death. One, we see that the death brought atonement to mankind. Two, it brought propitiation for sin. Three, it brought redemption. It brought reconciliation and access to God and deliverance. So basically, it's only through the death of Christ that today the world can have atonement from sin. We can have the propitiation. He is the go-between, the one that paid the price. And then, of course, Christ redeemed the world from the curse of the law. So everyone that is born again today, there's a redemption, not necessarily redemption from sin, but from the curse of the law. Because in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, we are redeemed from the curse of the law through the Lord Jesus Christ. The curse of the law is all the sicknesses and evil and infirmity and the evil thing that goes on in the world. And my prayer is that our redemption will be perfect and permanent in Jesus' name. So finally, we look at Christ's burial. Eventually, Jesus Christ was buried. But there's one thing I want us to learn there. God raised two secret disciples of Christ for his burial. These were one, Joseph of Arimathea, and the other was Nicodemus. Joseph of Arimathea made the provision for the place of the burial, and Nicodemus, a secret disciple, brought the spices for his burial, making sure that everything about Jesus, the death and burial, was perfected. My prayer is that that death, all that it brought for mankind, will be ours in Jesus' name. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. I want us to thank the Lord for this study this morning. It's a very big, large study that can take hours, but it's salient. Let's thank the Lord for the death of Christ at Calvary. Did Jesus not die? Where will I be today? But he died, and he rose again. He's no more in the grave. He's no more in the grave. He's risen. He's no longer at Golgotha. No, he's in heaven. He's the King of Kings. Let's tell the Lord the life of Christ, the new life of Christ, will reign much in our hearts and life. In Jesus' name, we pray. Almighty God, we thank you this morning. Thank you for the salient lesson from this study. I pray that, Lord, all you have taught us, give us the grace that we will appropriate them and our life will be better every day in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We are grateful unto God Almighty. Like our teacher said, if we continue, that the teaching is so exhaustive, full of lessons to learn, that it will take us hours to learn. But for the few minutes that we have devoted to it, beginning from the personal preparation, then we are in the class, and now the class is over. And I believe that by the grace of God, the lessons we ought to learn, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, the burial, a lot of characters surfaced in this trial. Pilate, that man, he was conscious of his position. Even when he knew the truth, I find no fault in this man. Several times, if you don't crucify this man, you're not a friend of Caesar. He now did what he did. He scorched him. Chapter 19, verse 1, scorched him, the Son of God. And all the other people, the soldiers, Mary Magdalene, Mary the wife of Cleopas, Mary the mother of Jesus, John the beloved that took the mother of Jesus. We have a lot of lessons to learn from each and individual character. I pray that the Lord God Almighty will help us in Jesus' name. Now, having concluded this lesson 880, do we have any question based on what our teacher has taught us? Brethren, let's make it straight to the point, and also remember there'll be no question after question. No question after question. The crucifixion and the burial of Jesus Christ. Any question, brethren? Question time is assessment time. The teacher will use this period to assess how far his teaching went. Do we have any question to ask?
Praise the Lord.
Question after question. Praise the Lord. Okay, we have one question coming from sister. Any other person that has a question to ask?
To no me, question after question. Has a question.
Huh?
Timoluwa has a question.
Oh, good job. Tell me. I think we'll start with you. Sister Vero, let's give our son an opportunity to ask his question first. Any other person? We'll have Tammy. We'll have sister. Any other person? Angela said no. Okay. Two people have questions. Go ahead and ask your question. Bye.
There's another person from the Ajiboye's family.
Oh, okay. That's three.
So, when we read in the Bible, Pilate, right? When they arrested Jesus and took him to Pilate to judge him, to see if he should be sentenced to death, Pilate tried to stop it. Pilate tried to stop the process. So, I want to know if it was bad that Pilate tried to stop, or if it's a good thing, because like Jesus was supposed to die and Pilate was trying to stop it, but at the same time he didn't want Jesus to leave the earth. So I want to know if it's a good thing or a bad thing that Pilate tried to not send Jesus to the cross.
Okay. Let's start answering our son's question. Praise the Lord. Our son is asking, Jesus Christ was ordained to die, and yet Pilate was trying to save him. Was it a good thing that Pilate was trying to do? Wonderful question, intelligent question, critical question that needs an analysis. My son, by the grace of God, we have seen that Jesus Christ came, number one, to die for us. And that was why when John the Baptist saw him, he said, behold, the Lamb of God that came to save the sins of the whole world. And why Paul the Apostle, by the Spirit of God, was referring to himself. He was telling Paul, Timothy, said, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into this world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. So understand, number one, that Jesus Christ came to save sinners, all of us. He came, his name is Jesus, for he came to save us from our sins. And everything that happened about him was tailored towards that direction. As a human being with human empathy, Pilate said, he's not going to die. It's like when Jesus Christ told Peter, I'm going to go to the cross. They are going to deliver me into the hands of sinners. And now that Peter said, no, far be it from me. It was empathetic. But he didn't know that he was not standing against the will of God. That's why Jesus Christ turned around and said, hey, you are always on the side of me. I must go to the cross. So, my son, it was the will of God. Pilate was just, this man, I have tried him, I have questioned him, there is no sin in him. He was being empathic. But that empathy was against the will of God. So which one will follow? The will of God must be done, and it was done. So Pilate was not sinning, he was just expressing his sympathy. This man that is not guilty of anything. All the false witnesses have gathered together, and their witnesses don't mind. Why do I have to crucify him? But the will of God must prevail. Praise the Lord. Tell me, you understand it now, that Pilate was not sinning. He was just sympathizing. He has the power. Remember, he said, I have the power to release you and to set you free. But setting Christ free is contrary to the will of God. Remember the prayer of Jesus Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane when they came to arrest him. Lord, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay. Now, our sister, you ask your question.
I thought there is a question from the Ajiboyes.
Yeah, but you indicated first that, or you want them to take the second slot?
Yes, sir.
Okay, the Ajiboyes, the person that has a question from the Ajiboye family, you have the opportunity to ask your question now.
My question is that the Nicodemus that came to Jesus at night, is it the same Nicodemus that gave Jesus the oil?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Where is it in the Bible?
If you read, it's, I think, one of the I will find out and let you know, because there was a place he said, who came to him in the night? So it was the same Nicodemus. When he was talking about the role that Nicodemus played, in burying Jesus. He said, who came to him in the night? Is it not in the same place we read today? Let's see. I know that is true. That is the same Nicodemus. But a reference was made to him about him who came to him in the night, referring to
reference. In the Bible, in the Bible reference.
Is somebody speaking?
Yes, sir. John chapter 3 in the Bible, if his Bible has a reference, he will see it there.
Yeah, I know it's in John chapter 3 when he came to Jesus Christ by night, but during the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, there was a place the Bible mentioned about Nicodemus who came to him at night.
Verse 39, I think. Verse 39, sir.
And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night. Praise the Lord. Sister, thanks the Lord. God bless you. So, Nehemiah, you have seen it that this Nicodemus that came along with Joseph of Arimathea to bury Jesus Christ is the same Nicodemus that came to him at night. John chapter 19, verse 39. Sister, Lord, God bless you. Okay, now you ask your own question. Nehemiah, do you have another question? We have shown you where it is in the Bible. It's the same Nicodemus. Okay, Sister Veronica, ask your question.
Yes, sir. Question number, what's question, answer to question number one? And then my other question is
hold on. I didn't get what you said.
Question number one.
From the side of the scripture?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's read it and see. Question number one. Can you read it, please?
It says, what challenge do we receive from Pilate's verdict about Jesus' innocence?
What challenge do we receive from Pilate's verdict about Jesus' innocence? So what do you think should be the answer? Go ahead. Ask your next question.
The next question is verse 11. And Jesus answered, thou couldst have no power at all against me except it were given to thee from above. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee had the greater sin. I would like for you to throw light into that, because we're told that there is no big sin, there is no small sin. What is Jesus saying here?
Okay, thanks a lot, my sister, God bless you. Beginning from the last question, he said, he that delivered me unto you had the greater sin. Who do you think he was referring to, sister?
I think he was referring to Judas Iscariot and the rest of the people who brought him to Pontius Pilate.
He was referring to Judas Iscariot.
Yeah, my question is.
Hold on, I'm coming. I understand your question. Now, you are talking about the greater sin. Sister, one of the greatest sins that a human being have committed here on earth is the sin that Judas Iscariot betrayed his master. That's what Jesus Christ said, that he that did it has committed the greater sin. The sin that is greater than all our sin is the sin of betraying Jesus Christ by betrayal of Jesus Christ by Judas Iscariot. Simple. You don't have the power to do anything except it was given for you from above. But he that have did this evil thing has the greater sin.
Oh, I thought there's no small sin, there's no big sin.
Huh?
I thought that there's no big sin and there's no small sin.
But this is the very word of the Bible. The great Jesus Christ says the greater sin. So what is the great sin and the small sin in the Bible?
Yeah, but now because he said great, there must be he said greater, so there must be great, sir.
So if we look at the Bible from the from word usage, we might be rare. If we use and interpret the Bible by singling out a word greater, we would derail from the scriptures. What Judas did, Jesus Christ, is the greater sin. Sin is sin. We're told that there's nothing like the big one or small. We're talking about New Testament believers. So I'm saying, it's only when you commit adultery, that's a great sin. Hey, when you tell lies, that in the sight of God is equal. When you bear false witness, in the sight of God is as equal as committing murder, killing somebody. The Bible also tells us that if you sin against God and against the Son of God, you'll be forgiven. But the sin against the Holy Ghost, no forgiveness. What do we do then? Do we say, okay, let me commit small sin? As a child of God, you flee all sin, flee from every sin, even the appearance of sin, run away. You cannot stand before God and say, hey, God, this one is small, this one is great, this one is medium size, this one is XS large. Flee, run away from all sin. But the emphasis is what Jesus Christ said, that this person, that remember what he said, that it would have been better for this person that would do this thing if he were not born. That's terrible. So let's not go by word interpretation. We single out a word and begin to analyze it the way we go, rise, great, greater, and greatest. We will derail from the scriptures. As a child of God, let's flee from all sin. It's the people outside that say, this one is small, this one is great. Hey, sin is sin in the sight of God. And I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Then next one is, what challenges do we receive from Pilate's verdict about Jesus' innocence? Who can help us there? Let's see and assess the class. What challenge do we receive from Pilate's verdict about Jesus' innocence? Does anybody have an answer? Pilate knew that Jesus Christ was innocent, yet he gave him up to be crucified. Why? Well, I explained it at the beginning. They said, if you don't do this, you are not Caesar's friend. Because of his position, he did that which was wrong. He yielded to pressure. He was a man pleaser, a man pleaser. Wanted to please them. He knew the right thing to do, that this man had not committed anything and ought not to die. But because of the pressure, and mostly because, like we said, that was the will of God that he must die. So, brethren, the lesson we learn from that is that we should not yield to pressure. When we know the right thing to do as a father, as a mother, even in school, even at work, do the right thing. Don't yield to pressure. If you don't do this thing, you will lose your job. He says it's better for me to lose my job and keep the standard of the word of God. I remember the story of that individual who said he's not gonna make cake for wedding of homosexuals. Oh, the society ran their mouth. You. You don't bring your faith in the workplace. Then you don't. The woman said, "I will stand my ground," and she stood her ground. That's the kind of example we're supposed to follow. Don't yield to pressure from outside. When you are standing for God, stand for God. The disciples said we ought to obey God rather than man. If it means our dying, let us die. Sudden death, sudden glory. And I pray the Lord will give us the same grace that he granted unto the apostles to hearken to the voice of the Lord and not to the pressure from outside in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and pray. Let's rise up, brethren. What have you learned? Consider the questions that our youth asked. Brethren, we thank God for them. Thank God for their lives. Pilate wanting to release Jesus Christ. Was it right? He was just sympathetic of him. How can I sentence, crucify somebody, pass sentence of death on somebody that did not commit any sin yet? The will of God must be done. The will of God overrides human empathy. The Nicodemus we read in chapter 19, is it the same in chapter 3? Oh, yes. Chapter 19, verse 39, who came to him at night, referring to chapter 3, is the same Nicodemus. What Judas Iscariot did is a greater sin. It's very terrible. I pray that the Lord will give us the grace not to betray the Lord by living a life contrary to the will of God. When we say we are believers and we are living a life contrary, we are denying and betraying him. They say, ah, look at him, look at her. He says he goes to church. Look at what he did. Look at what she did. Father, we thank you, Almighty God, for this morning. We exalt and glorify your gracious name, Lord God Almighty. What you have taught us this morning and what the answers you have given unto us have enlightened us more and more. And it has also helped us to assess our teaching. Oh, Lord God, Father, we bless and magnify your name in Jesus' name. Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We thank God for the teaching of the Word of God, for the questions and answers. I pray that God will increase our understanding in Jesus' name. We will continue with our fellowship by singing from our gospel hymn and song, hymn number 79. I must need go home by the way of the cross. There is no other way for this. I shall never get sight of the gate of light if the way of the cross I miss. The way of the cross lead on. The way of the cross lead on. It is sweet to know as I onward go, the way of the cross lead on. Hymn number 79. 23, no other plea. My faith has found a resting place, not in device nor creed. I trust the ever-living one. His wound for me shall plead. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. Hymn number 2-3. Thank you. Amen. I pray the purpose of him dying and all that he went through for you and I to be saved will not be in vain in Jesus' name. Let us pray. I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these shall be added unto you. Let's commit ourselves to God in prayer, as we have learned today from our study scripture, seeking the will, the purpose, and the plan of God for our life. In any circumstances and situation, pray for the grace and the power to be able to fulfill the purpose of God for your life in Jesus' name. We read that despite everything that happened, the will of God must be fulfilled. Pray for the grace, for the power, the knowledge, the strength to be able to make his will and purpose be fulfilled in your life. In time of persecution, the grace to go through the shame and the suffering that is needed, as the Bible says that he that will live godly in Christ must suffer persecution. Pray for the spirit of gentleness and calmness, self-confidence and reliance on God in any circumstances and situation that you might be facing. I'm going to read from Proverbs chapter 14, verse 34. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to anyone. We want to pray for Nigeria, that the righteousness of God will reign in that nation. We want to pray for against every wickedness in the heart of man, that God will use these circumstances and situation to bring souls into this kingdom. Pray for anybody that might be going through spirit of depression, spirit of suicide, and so many calamities at this time, that God himself will visit them by his spirit. Remember, devil come but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. The mind of the devil is to use these circumstances to bring people to hell. Let's also use these circumstances for the kingdom of God to be expanded. I'm going to read from Psalm 93, verse 1. It says, the Lord reigneth. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he has guided himself. The world also is stabilized, that it cannot be moved. Let's pray for stability in Nigeria against all the chaotic situation regarding the policy. Let's pray that God will bring everything calm. It will bring peace to the heart of Christians in Nigeria, and it will establish his will concerning the situation in the country in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 6, verse 13. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. We want to pray for our brethren, converts of the CGK, the crusade and everything going on, that God will establish them. He will give them the strength to overcome every evil. God will establish his kingdom in Nigeria at this time, in the heart of men, in Jesus' name. Let's pray for the forthcoming election that is coming. We're going to read from Proverbs chapter 15, verse 22. Without counsel, purpose are disappointed, but in the multitude of counselors, they are established. We want to pray that all the people that will be around, that will be executing this election, God will put his fear, his spirit, the righteousness of God in their mind, in Jesus' name, to make the will of God fulfilled, in Jesus' name. We want to pray for God to choose for Nigeria the right leader that will be able to rule that country in the righteousness of God, according to the will and the purpose of God. In 1 Timothy, it says, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplication, prayer, intercession, and giving of thanks be made to all, for all men, for the kings, and for all they who are in authority, that they may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God. We learn today about Pilate. What Pilate did, the fear of men, he did not execute, he was man pleaser. Although what he did is according to the will of God, but we want to pray for Buhari and all the ministers and all the judges at this time, that God will put his honor in their mind, his godliness in their heart. He will make them to be able to do that, to enthrone only those people that God have chosen, in Jesus' name. And let's pray for people as they fall vote. They will vote righteousness. They will vote holiness. They will vote peace. Let's come against every spirit of sucking blood in the country. Post-election peace. Let's pray that there's going to be post-election peace, a peaceful situation in Nigeria. There will not be riot of killing, of fighting, of destruction of property, in Jesus' name. Pray for yourself. As this world is coming to the end, that you and I will not miss the kingdom, in Jesus' name. The power to stand in righteousness and contend for the faith. That God will help us to execute them in our life, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.